What better way to welcome the holiday season than by calculating these monstrous integrals? And today is a very special integral. It's the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of x times sine x times the cosine of x times the logarithm of sine x times the logarithm of cosine x. Wow, that is one hell of an integral. Now, how do we approach it? Well, it's the x term over here that's a bit pesky, so I'd like to get rid of it by introducing a phase shift. And what do I mean by that? Well, we know that the integral from a to b of f of x dx equals the integral from a to b of f of a plus b minus x dx. And this can be proved using a simple u substitution. And what this property of the definite integral means is that integration from left to right is the same thing as integration from right to left. That is, adding up those little chunks of area under the curve gives you the same thing whether you add them from left to right or from right to left. And this is, of course, a property of the definite integral itself and was probably discovered by Riemann himself. And it's very, very surprising that this property is popularized across the internet as King's rule or King's property, although I have not read a single piece of mathematical literature calling this King's rule. And I have never heard of a mathematician who claims to have discovered this property, which is, again, just a basic property of the definite integral itself. Anyway, so in our case, a equals 0 and b equals pi by 2. So I is now the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of pi by 2 minus x, where we've transitioned from the x realm to the pi by 2 minus x realm, of course. So we have pi by 2 minus x times the sine of pi by 2 minus x times the cosine. And of course, these phase shifts of pi by 2 turn the trigonometric ratios into their co-ratios. So I have cosine x, and by the same token, sine x times the logarithm of cosine x times the logarithm of sine x dx. So I have all of this stuff being multiplied by pi by 2 minus x. So let me just apply the multiplication followed by the linearity of the definite integral, and I get the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of pi by 2 times the cosine of x, but wait, pi by 2 is just a constant, so I can write it out here, cosine x times sine x times log cosine x times log sine x dx minus the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of x times all of that stuff, which we recognize as the integral I. So on the left-hand side, I have I, and on the right-hand side, I have negative I. So that means I could just add I to both sides of my equation and get 2 times I, followed by an expansion using a factor of 1/2, and I get pi by 4 times this new integral. And how do I evaluate this new simplified structure? Well, we could apply Feynman's trick to a very special function, that special function being the beta function. So the beta function with complex arguments u and v is twice the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of sine to the 2u minus 1 of x times cosine to the 2v minus 1 of x dx. So we're pretty much covered in terms of the sine and the cosine parts. We just have to plug in the relevant values, the appropriate values of u and v, but I need the logarithms of these sines and cosines, and that's pretty easy to generate as well. All I have to do is differentiate the beta function with respect to its arguments, first with respect to u, and using differentiation under the integral sign, I have the integral from 0 to pi by 2. This term independent of u is a constant in the u realm, or partial differentiation, of course. And differentiating the sine term gives me the repeated function times the logarithm of the constant base of sine x. And because of the chain rule, differentiating 2u minus 1 gives me an extra factor of 2. So I have a factor of 4 outside. Okay, so that's the logarithm of sine x. And for the logarithm of cosine x, I could just differentiate again with respect to v. So this mixed partial derivative of the beta function is now 8 times the integral from 0 to pi by 2 of cosine to the 2v minus 1 of x times sine to the 2u minus 1 of x times the logarithm of cosine x times the logarithm of sine x dx. And we need sine and cosine to the first power. So for that, I need 2v minus 1 equal to 1, which implies that v equals 1, and the same holds for u. Okay, so this implies that I, the target integral, equals pi by 4 times 1/8 of this thing here. And we evaluate this mixed second partial at uv equals 1 and 1. Now to differentiate the beta function twice. So we can do that pretty easily by using the relation between the beta and the gamma functions. So beta uv equals gamma u times gamma v divided by gamma u plus v. And differentiating this with respect to u first, we have this constant term of gamma v outside, and applying the quotient rule to the rest of the structure gives me gamma u plus v times gamma prime u minus gamma u times gamma prime u plus v divided by gamma squared u plus v. And I can simplify the structure quite a bit by using the relationship between the derivative of the gamma function and the digamma function. So the digamma function, psi s, is defined as the logarithmic derivative of the gamma function. And this, of course, would be gamma s downstairs and gamma prime s upstairs because of the chain rule, which implies that the derivative of the gamma function at s equals gamma s times digamma s. Okay, cool. So writing out the structure for gamma prime u and gamma prime u plus v, that means what I have is partial beta by partial u equal to gamma v times gamma u plus v gamma u digamma u minus gamma u plus v times digamma u plus v. Okay, cool. And then we have the squared gamma function evaluated at u plus v in the denominator. So I can factor out gamma u plus v and gamma u. And I also have the squared gamma function in the denominator. So that means I can write this as gamma u gamma v divided by gamma u plus v, where the gamma u plus v term in the denominator cancels out with the squared term in the denominator. Okay, so I'm now left with gamma u minus digamma u minus digamma u plus v. And this thing here is just the beta function evaluated at u and v times digamma u minus digamma u plus v. Now, differentiating it once makes life a lot easier for another differentiation, because the beta function is symmetric in both u and v. So this implies that the second partial, which we get by now differentiating with respect to v, is by the product rule, first the derivative of the beta function with respect to v, which gives us the repeated beta function times digamma v minus digamma u plus v. And the structure tags along, digamma u minus digamma u plus v. Okay. And now for the other half of the product rule, we have the beta function as it is. And the derivative of the digamma function is the trigamma function, but the first term here is independent of the v parameter, so that means I'll have a negative sign. So I have minus beta, and I'm now left with trigamma u plus v. Okay, cool. And my target case was u equal to v equal to 1. So this implies that partial square beta by partial v partial u evaluated at 1 and 1 is the beta function at 1 and 1, which is, of course, equal to 1 because gamma 1 and gamma 2 are both equal to 1. And I have the die gamma function at 1 minus the die gamma function at 2, the same thing over here, so this is just squared, minus again 1 for the beta function, and I have tri gamma 2 here. For values of the die gamma function, we recall that die gamma s equals gamma prime s by gamma s. So for its value at 1, we need the derivative of the gamma function at 1 divided by the gamma function at 1, which is, of course, 1. But what is the derivative of the gamma function at 1? Don't you just wish you could just glance down on your hoodie or your shirt or your coffee mug and that would have the important derivatives of the gamma function on it? Well, now you can. You can purchase such merchandise using the link below. Thanks. Anyway, so this implies that die gamma 1 equals, according to my cool hoodie, negative Euler-Mascheroni constant. Okay, and by the same token, I have the die gamma function at 2 being equal to gamma prime at 2 is 1 minus the Euler-Mascheroni constant, and gamma 2 is just 1 anyway. So this is what I have so far. And now for the trigamma function. Now, the trigamma function has this really cool series expansion that is trigamma z equals the sum over n of 1 by n plus z squared. So we have to sum over the non-negative integers here. So just by plugging in z equal to 2, that means we have the sum over the positive integers n of 1 by n plus 2 squared. And we could just expand this and we'll have 1 by 2 squared plus 1 by 3 squared plus 1 by 4 squared and so on and so forth. And if I add to this a factor of 1, and I can do that by subtracting 1 as well, then this here is just the Basel identity that is pi squared by 6. So that means I have pi squared by 6 minus 1. So this implies that trigamma 2 equals pi squared by 6 minus 1. Now to put all the pieces together, I have, terribly sorry about that, negative Euler-Mascheroni constant minus 1 plus Euler-Mascheroni constant, everything squared. They cancel out, minus pi squared by 6 minus 1. So what I'm left with is, wait, much better. What I'm left with is 1 minus negative 1, that's a 2. So I have 2 minus pi squared by 6 equal to the second derivative of the beta function with respect to u and v. And of course, my target integral was pi by 32 times this thing. So this is, in fact, what I get. And this is a pretty cool result for a monstrous integral. I hope you enjoyed the video. Be sure to like and subscribe. Be sure to check out the merchandise. Thank you. See you next time.